Good afternoon. My name is Peter Sharoshian from Budapest, Hungary. Today I will tell you a story of a country that had a relatively advanced harm reduction system in the beginning of the 21st century, and I will tell you how it fell back into a zero tolerance approach because of lack of financial resources, but mostly because of political populism, which is unfortunately hitting my country now. So harm reduction in Hungary started in the early 90s, where the first harm reduction programs were created, and the first needle exchange program was established in 1993, and our first national drug strategy in 2000, in the year 2000, approved harm reduction programs, and in 2007 a social welfare law created a legal basis for the funding of these programs, and in 2014 we had 31 needle and syringe programs in the country. Actually, most of the drug use in my country, it's a very small country with 10 million people, and 2 million people live in the capital, Budapest, and most of the injecting drug use is concentrating in the capital, in Budapest. So the two largest needle and syringe programs provided 55% of all the needles in the country. And OST coverage was quite low in Hungary, and HIV and hepatitis prevalence among the injecting drug users also remained relatively low compared to, for example, Eastern European countries. So, for example, hepatitis C prevalence among injecting drug users before 2011, it was not much more than 20%. And what happened in 2009, 2010 was there was a huge shift in the drug market in Hungary. So before that, heroin and amphetamine dominated the illicit drug market, especially the injecting drug use. And in that year, new psychoactive substances came to Hungary from, you know, these drugs were produced in China and India, and they almost completely replaced heroin and amphetamine, which is a quite unique phenomenon in Europe. There is only one country, Romania, according to my knowledge, where this happened. So like heroin almost disappeared from the market, and almost all users switched to, from heroin and amphetamine, they switched to catinones like methadrone and other synthetic stimulants, which were easily and cheap available. You know, that also meant that the drug market is in a constant change, because these substances are changing. You know, as soon the government is banning one substance, a new substance is coming. So, you know, these substances have different dosage and different use and different mechanism of effects. So that meant that this changing market in and itself was a risk for drug users. And the characteristics of this new psychoactive substance injectors, for example, is that they use or they injected much more frequently than drug users before. So it's not rare that people inject 15, 20 times a day. And that means that sharing of injecting equipment increased, and the risk of infections also increased among the new psychoactive substance injectors. And there is also a trend to inject in an unsafe environment more than heroin users, so that new psychoactive substances don't need cooking, for example, so people can use them much more easily. And we had much more cases of hospitalization due to paranoia and psychosis with new psychotic substance users. In 2010, this change in the drug market corresponded with the political change. So there was a change of government in Hungary in 2010. And maybe some of you know that we had a quite conservative government with Prime Minister Orban, with a populistic policy. And actually the new government rejected the drug strategy that was approved by the previous administration, which was very much pro harm reduction national drug strategy. So they rejected that, and they also restricted our criminal laws, so they increased punishment for drug use and drug possession. And they also had a new recovery-oriented approach, which is it was more like abstinence-based approach. So they were rejecting the concept of harm reduction. And in 2013, they adopted a new national drug strategy, which actually aimed to create a drug-free Hungary by 2020, which is a very ambitious and very stupid goal, of course. And parallel to these changes, the drug budget was in the decline also. You see on this graph. So when government had this rhetorics of course we will stop drug use and making a drug-free country, but at the same time they drastically cut the budget of recovery programs and harm reduction programs, and that means that in 2011 there was a huge decline in the availability of needles. And the services, the needle and syringe services, were very, very underfunded. So there is a professional protocol for needle and syringe programs in Hungary, and that requires that all programs have to employ 3.5 staff members for each program. But actually, the programs don't get enough money from the government even to pay for the salary of the social workers working at the needle exchange programs, not to mention, buying equipment and all other, related social services. So that meant like a really bad, they got into a very difficult situation. And the government created a new action plan which didn't mention harm reduction at all. As I mentioned to you, the two largest needle and syringe programs were in Budapest. And there is one part of Budapest, the District 8, which is a district where many people live in poverty and their unemployment is quite high. And there are thousands of injecting drug users in that only in that district. Most of these people belong to the Roma minority, who are, discriminated and who are segregated in the Hungarian society. And there was a new mayor, of course, from the ruling party of this populist conservative party, and he scapegoated the local needle and syringe programs for the problems in the districts. So he said that the needle and syringe program attracts drug users to his district, and he said that he accused the needle and syringe programs to spreading drug litter on the streets, and spread fear in the population that your children will jump into its needles, and actually that that drug litter issue was dominating the discourse on needle and syringe programs, even if there was not a single documented case when anyone was injured by needles, but there was many documented cases of getting infected by sharing needles. So this mayor organized a demonstration in front of the needle and syringe program with some, misled local residents, actually he started a smear campaign against the needle exchange program, and in 2014 it had to shut down the program, and just shortly after that the other big needle and syringe programs also shut down in another part of town, because from that program, all the clients from that program moved to the other part of the city, and the mayor there also said, we can't take that, and he just closed the other program. So that means that more than 50% of Hungarian needle provision just stopped from one week to another in Hungary. So that was a declining access to needles, you can see in that graph. That the needle distribution was like declining very sharply, and that WHO recommends to have at least 200 clean needles per drug users per year, while now in Hungary there is like approximately 30 needles per person per year, and at the same time the clients who visit needle exchange programs the number of clients is going up, so there is a more need for needles but less supply of needles. So the consequence of this situation is a growing hepatitis C epidemic in Hungary. According to the National Center of Epidemiology data, the prevalence of HCV among injecting drug users rose from 34% to 60% in 3 years. And you know, when Hep C is going up, that's always a sign of a new HIV epidemic. So we are now pretty much afraid that, like in Romania and other countries, we are facing a new HIV epidemic among injecting drug users. The problem is that we were, you know, trying to convince the local and national government about, you know, we have to respond to this threat. And there were many, you know, debates, and there was even a political debate in the television, it was a televised debate where I was debating a government politician. And why I mentioned it, that you know, sometimes scientific evidence is not enough to support harm reduction, because I was citing data of the National Epidemiological Center, and the government politician said that, "I don't believe your data, I don't trust your data, because that is collected through needle and syringe programs. So that, I don't trust the needle and syringe program, so that's why your data is not reliable, so I don't care that." So even if we have the data in Hungary and, you know, hard facts, but you know, this debate is so much emotional. And when we realized that, we created a campaign, because we realized that the key is to convince the local people, you know, who are manipulated by the local mayor. And we had an advocacy campaign that was called the Room in the Eight campaign. And the aim was to address local neighborhoods, you know, people who live there. And and actually, we created messages which try to convince people that harm reduction is good for them. It's not only good for drug users, but it's good for the people who live around and live with drug users. So that, you know, people who use drugs are part of the community. And so we created the campaign movie, and we were going to the streets and collecting signatures. We had a campaign website, so we did it online, offline, different methods, had some meetings with the local community. We also got some money to have, you know, city lights advertisements on the street. Actually, even the Ombudsman for Civil Liberties supported our campaign by stating that harm reduction is beneficial for the whole society, and it does not only about, you know, protecting the right to health, but it's also protecting the right to healthy environment, which is very important when you try to convince people who are not drug users, but who live in areas where are affected by drug use. So unfortunately, still, you know, we have this populist government, and unfortunately, still the needle and syringe programs are closed in Hungary. Why this story is interesting is that Hungary is a case where the problem is not mostly it's not the lack of financial resources, or at least, you know, the government does not provide adequate resources, but that's not because they don't have the resources, but it's purely an ideological opposition to the idea of harm reduction. And this is happening in the middle of the European Union, you know, where the European Union has a drug strategy that is pro-harm reduction, and the Hungarian government even signed that, but still they don't really implement that. So that shows that, you know, there is a limit of this international multilateral agreements and recommendations when it comes to implementation of these programs at the local level. And even if you know, there is a, the government does not say that we want to shut down needle and syringe programs, but there is no political leadership in the national level, and the local governments can stop harm reduction programs without any, you know, without any support from the national government. So there is no leadership for that in Hungary. And I think it's also important to mention, or it's one lesson learned is that harm reduction does not exist, you know, isolated from the larger political environment. So when, for example, in Hungary, civil society is scapegoated, and we have now a law discussed by the Hungarian parliament that requires us, NGOs receiving international fundings, to register as foreign agents. and that is imported from Russia. And you know, our government is saying that we are foreign agents, and we are spreading, you know, some ideology coming from the West, and we are not part of the Hungarian nation. And in this environment, it's really difficult to do any kind of advocacy. So, yeah, this is it. Thank you.